Hey, thank you everyone for coming. We'll get started. We're on the third paragraph of Shema. It's a very interesting thing if you want to follow along the Art Scroll Siddur, among many other places in the Art Scroll English, it's page 94. It's a very interesting thing. The whole concept of this third paragraph of Shema is somewhat surprising, truth be told. The first paragraph, this sounded a bit. Is it possible to close that door? Is it possible?
You have to talk loud.
It's easier for me to talk louder than for you to listen louder. Thank you very much, Judy. Okay, so the idea of the first paragraph, as we discussed, is acceptance of the yoke of heaven, and we looked at it as this broad understanding of a relationship with God and a sense of affection for God. The second paragraph had to do with accepting a yoke of mitzvos, of commandments, understanding that there could be rewards for doing the right things, there could be repercussions for doing the wrong things. And then we have this third paragraph, which, not that this is the say-all and end-all, it's in a totally separate part of the Chumash. I'll have you know that as I'm preparing this shir last night, I very happily said, okay, and now let me pull out my Chumash to see some of the classic commentators on these verses, and I pulled out the Chumash that I used to prepare the last 2 weeks of Shiurim, and it was the wrong book. You know, the first two chapters were from Sefer Tvarim, and lo and behold, the third chapter was Sefer Bamidbar. I don't know when that happened, but it's a different section of the Chumash.
Thousands of years ago.
Yeah, it's very good. It's really, at least at surface, does not seem to be this broad statement of our relationship with God. Seems to be very specific about a very specific mitzvah, tzitzis. Just an interesting thing. So the Gemara in Brachos poses this question: why did the rabbi see fit to connect this to the first two paragraphs of Shema? By the way, it's very clear that the third paragraph of Shema, the whole idea of saying third paragraph of Shema, is rabbinic in nature. So the Gemara lists a few things that come out of this paragraph that the rabbi seemed to feel was very appropriate to say twice a day in conjunction with the other parts of Shema. So one is, there is a concept of the acceptance of mitzvos in this paragraph. The Torah talks about the fact that you'll see the tzitzis, and when you see the tzitzis, you'll remember to keep God's mitzvos. So this fits very well with the preceding paragraph, one thing. Second thing is there's an extremely important theme of remembering the Exodus. Remembering the Exodus is so core to how we relate to God. It's actually interesting that we really didn't talk about that in the first two paragraphs of Shema, right? It's core to how we relate to God. It's core to how we relate to God on different levels. One is, there's no such thing as a free ride. You know, he took us out of Egypt expecting something. You know, and this is what he expects. But I think on what we'd probably find is a more meaningful level is that the experience of the Exodus emphasizes how beloved we are in God's eyes, emphasizes the special relationship between God and the Jewish people, emphasizes the great potential that he sees within the Jewish people, that he performed miracles and wonders to take us out, emphasizes the sense of fairness, whether or not we always see that fairness, whether or not we always see that justice, I should say, whether or not we see that all the time, the belief that when it's all said and done, there is justice, maybe in this world, maybe in the next world, maybe 10 generations down the road in this world, who knows? There's so many ideas. So this is one of the concepts that comes out of this paragraph. So acceptance of mitzvos, remembering the Exodus, of course, the specific mitzvah of tzitzis is mentioned here too. And also in this paragraph, it touches on some of the things that are pitfalls for us spiritually. It touches on following our hearts, and the Gemara understands that following our hearts are when people are tempted to leave the path of Judaism, follow other belief systems and other faiths that are at odds with Judaism potentially. That's how the Gemara understands to follow one's heart, to follow one's eyes, it's to follow certain temptations in sin. And there's even a language of don't go after the things which you are zonim acharem, almost like follow in a zona is like a language when people are not appropriate in marriage type of language, and you know, go to another partner in an inappropriate manner. So zonim refers to following of other gods. So the Gemara says that there's a lot packed within this paragraph that has to do with the broad relationship between God and the Jewish people. And that, says the Gemara, is why the rabbis attached this to the first two paragraphs of Shema. Okay, let's get started. Vayomer Hashem Moshe Limor. And God said to Moshe, Limor, to say that he in turn should relate to the Jewish people. Daber b'nei Yisrael v'yomar to aleihem. Speak to the Jewish people and say to them, v'yasu lohem tzitzis al kanfei v'gdehem l'darosam. That they should make for themselves tzitzis, you know, these fringes, on the corners of their garments for their generations, v'nosnu al tzitzis hakonof tzil t'cheles. And on these fringes on the corners should be the strand of t'cheles. Many today, check another lecture sponsored by the Rosenthals for a discussion of Tcheles. Baruch Hashem, the Rosenthals hosted a lecture a year ago, within the past year. Yeah. On the topic of Tcheles, it's a fascinating discussion in Jewish observance today. Many are of the belief that they have figured out what the Tcheles is, but in any event, some people wear it today, some people don't. But this bluish string that you see more and more, that's the Tcheles they're referring to here. Okay. There's something that jumps out at this in this pasuk, which is Dabir is a language of speech, and Amarta is a language of speech. But why the redundancy? Why the repetition? And to the extent that there's an idea of repeating, why the two different languages? Dabir b'nei Yisrael, v'amarta lehem. Two languages of speech, why is that? So, Lora Chaim says an interesting thing. Lora Chaim says, Dibur is frequently associated with a little bit of a stern type of tone, a command. That's frequently how Dibur is understood. And Amira is telling, explaining, that's normally how Amira is understood. Amarta is normally understood in that manner. So the Rachayim says that God is telling Moshe to relate this to the Jewish people on two levels. First level is, it happens to be a command. It does happen to be a command. That if a male is wearing a four-cornered garment, he's commanded to put tzitzis on. But it's not only a command. V'amarta lehem. Tell them, explain to them that this whole concept of tzitzis is so much to their benefit. So do both. Tell them it's not up for grabs, this is not negotiable, but also explain to them why if it was negotiable, they'd benefit from it greatly anyway, they should be negotiating for it. And it's an interesting way to begin the paragraph because obviously the comment was made in an earlier week, and it's all the more so here. How in the world is a person who doesn't have the obligation of tzitzis supposed to relate to this paragraph? And many of us here don't have the obligation of tzitzis. So tzitzis is a mitzvah, but tzitzis is much broader than a mitzvah. Because tzitzis is the concept of always remembering the mitzvahs. And we could talk about why some have the mitzvah, some don't have the mitzvah. But we all have the concept of always remembering the mitzvahs. And that's the point that this Orach Chaim is making. That part of it is a command, and part of it is a message. And the message is relevant to all of us. So that's something to think about a little bit. We'll elaborate as we go. What does the word tzitzis actually mean? You know, what does that mean? I'm curious.
Yeah.
If anyone was curious, the art scroll hits the nail on the head. The English translates it as tzitzis. Silly question. So one possibility is that tzitzis could be a language of like an edge, a string type of thing, string on the edge. So that would seem to be the easiest way to think of it. That's what Pshat Rashi brings down. There is also the possibility that tzitzis, we have a language in Shir HaShirim, Meitzitz Min HaCharakim. And Meitzitz in that context means to gaze. That tzitzis is the thing that we're supposed to look at. And that, of course, it's going to come out in these following psukim. That the big idea of tzitzis is we're supposed to look at it and remember something. And we see the tzitzis. Okay.
Lord Sachs says it's tassels.
Tassels. Thank you. So that would fit like with the first.
You tzitzis on the coming.
Yeah. What the word root connection to that is, my guess actually is that it's more a language of gazing. In other words, that people see it, that it catches people's eyes, that you look at him and it's, I think so, I could be wrong, but I am. Yeah, thank you. Okay. So it says in the pasuk that you should make this, that we should make this tzitzis on the corners of the garments, ludorosam, for the generations. An interesting one. Okay, I mean, aren't all these commandments supposed to be for generations? Why does it emphasize ludorosam? And the Orachayim says an interesting thing. The Orachayim says, they understand that if the reason for the tzitzis is to remember the mitzvahs of God, understand that all generations need this. One might think, maybe some generations are more deficient than others, maybe some generations are more elevated than others, so some people should have tzitzis. Other people don't need tzitzis, other people won't benefit from tzitzis. All generations need tzitzis. All generations need this reminder. That's how the Aruch Haim understands the pasuk. V'nasnu. Oh, I'm sorry, one more point. The idea of putting it on the kanfei v'gdehem, on the corner of the garment. Rashi makes a beautiful point. Rashi, again, this is definitely not the literal meaning of the pasuk, but Rashi says that there's an additional meaning. There's a very different phrase that uses the word kanfei, which in this context means corner. V'eso eschem al kanfei nesharim. In the ultimate redemption, God says, I'll carry you on the wings of eagles. So Rashi says, if you put the tzitzis on the corner of your garment, and again, if we're looking at this as more than an action, if you make the memory of the mitzvos and focus on the mitzvos a very valuable, vibrant part of your lives, again, regardless of gender, you'll hit the point of v'eso eschem al kanfei nesharim, of God carrying us away on the wings of eagles. It's an interesting thing to think about. Okay. Let's go on to the next verse. You know, I want to just cover a little more ground before we take comments, okay?
One comment is a question.
I want to cover a little more ground before we take questions. Vayalachem litzitzis. And it will be for you this tzitzis. Urisemosa. And you'll see the tzitzis. Uzkartem es kol mitzvos Hashem. And you'll remember all the commandments of God. Vasi semosa. And then you'll do those mitzvos. Velo sasubru achrei levavchem liachrei enechem. Do not wander, do not follow after your eye, after your hearts and after your eyes. Asher atem zonim achareihem. That you wander after these things. Okay, this was a lot said in this pasuk. So the first thing is, you'll look at the tzitzis and you'll remember the commandments of God. What is it about the tzitzis that's supposed to symbolize the commandments of God? This is a very famous Rashi over here. A little bit difficult to understand, but I'm gonna share it. Rashi says that tzitzis, the word tzitzis, is gematria of the numerical equivalent of the letters, adds up to 600. Okay? Now, each corner of the tzitzis has 8 strings, and there are 5 knots on each corner. So 600 plus 8 plus 5 comes to 613, a very famous Rashi. The Ramban says something else. The Ramban basically says it's hard to understand, you know, why. And by the way, he says, not all those things that Rashi described about the tzitzis are Torah required in the first place. The Torah doesn't require there to be 5 knots on each corner. You know, it's... So the Ramban says something else. The Ramban says it's really all about the tchelis. It's really all about this blue color on that string. There's a famous medrash that, I'm not going to get this right, but the blue, when I look at the blue of the string, I'm supposed to think of the blue of the sea, and when I think of the blue of the sea, I'm supposed to think of the blue of the sky. I think I'm missing one or two things in between. And that is supposed to bring me to thinking about God. So the Ramban says that's what we mean. When I look at the tchelis, that sharp color, and it reminds me of this expanse of things, the expanse of the water, the expanse of the heaven, and that makes me think of God. If I think of God, and I think of how much dominion God has over this world, and how much beauty God brings into this world, then how could I not be moved to keep God's mitzvos? That's what the Ramban says. And he says, that's why it says in the pasuk, Uzchartem es kol mitzvos Hashem. You'll remember all the mitzvos of God. It doesn't say remember God's commandments. It doesn't say this. It says remember all of God's commandments, because the Ramban says the whole point is the tchelas, that color, is supposed to remind one of the expanse of things. So if you see the expanse of God in this world, how could you not be moved to fulfill the expanse of his mitzvos? I do not believe the Ramban says this, but I'm just struck by it. I do not think this is the meaning here, but maybe on some level, it's very interesting. What are the middle letters of the word tcheles?
Kol.
In other words, the Ramban's whole point is that tcheles represents this concept of expanse. So kol means everything, the whole broad range. Just an interesting thing to think about. As an aside, the Ramban says, if you look at the water, the blue of the water, the blue of the heaven, of the sky, up close, it's not going to look that similar. It's when you take a step back, when you see it more from a distance, that's when things seem a more similar hue. And that's just a little bit of an interesting statement, that sometimes you can only appreciate the breadth of something from a bit of a distance. Something to think about. Okay. Maybe we'll pause now for, let me cover a little bit further. So there's another interesting thing in the verse. So you see this tzitzis, you shouldn't be distracted by your thing, by your temptations and thoughts that might be inappropriate. Focus on the tzitzis. And don't, lo sasuru. Sasuru, we translate as don't follow. Now the real shoresh of lo sasuru is a language of like spying, or touring is a better. It's always so interesting because this section of the Torah is at the end of Parshas Shlach, the story of the Meraglim, the story of the spies. And this root is used in describing what the spies did. Menatarim esaretz. They were the one who toured the land, walked through the land. So Rashi just says over here that the heart and the eyes are like spies for the rest of the body. And then, by the way, they could be spies for the rest of the body to bring back a wonderful report, you know, to guide us towards very good things. But it's just interesting. So that's how Rashi understands the language here. Rav Schwab makes an interesting comment. Rav Schwab says, you know, we mentioned already that the word zonim is frequently translated as following, but zonim really means to act in an unfaithful manner towards one's partner. It's a very strong word choice. So Rav Schwab says, if you follow your heart and your eyes, the day will come where you really act in an unfaithful way towards God. In other words, again, that doesn't mean that everybody's perfect, doesn't mean that we're expected to be perfect, but it's a very reasonable thing. Listen, I believe in God, I do this mitzvah, I do that mitzvah. Every now and then I kind of stray off the path a little bit. Now that's true for all of us. All of us stray off the path a little bit. But in outlook, one has to be very focused on trying to keep the word of God as precisely as we can. That's the point that he makes here in the Pasuk. Okay, I've spoken for a while. Any comments or questions on anything we've said up until this point? Mark, did you want to say something before?
Yeah, how does this apply to women?
Right, so we're going to still go a little bit further in the language of the psukim, but truth be told, I think we have to say there's two things going on here, at least. There's a command of tzitzis, and there is a perspective of what that command is supposed to bring us. And again, I mentioned this last week, but I think it certainly fits here today too. Rav Hirsch has this famous idea that he discusses many of the mitzvah differences between men and women. And he just talks about the fact that we're taught in different ways that women have more of an inherent spirituality. And that men have this obligation that if they have a four-cornered garment, they need to wear tzitzis on the garment to remind them of this. Then the other women don't have that obligation. They don't. It comes more naturally to them. But the message of the importance of remembering God's mitzvos, whether or not one is wearing tzitzis. By the way, I want to point out, the Torah mitzvah tzitzis is only if you happen to be wearing a four-cornered garment. You know, many observant men today, as we're taught to do, have an interesting practice of making our business to wear a four-cornered garment to put tzitzis on that four-cornered garment. But the truth is, men don't have an absolute obligation to wear tzitzis either. It's the obligation if we have a four-cornered garment. But the point seems to be this message of always needing to have focus and interest in God and His mitzvahs. And I think that message applies to all of us. I think so. Yeah. Thank you. Any other man?
Look at Sisyphus as a hope and just accept it for what it is, or you can ask questions and I'm going to cover them.
Okay.
So why
don't you hear the questions, then I'll decide if we're just going to accept it as a hope. Yeah.
So why is there a repetition of the word Sisyphus? And another one is there something symbolic about the way the Sisyphus look, about a deeper meaning? So if we're going to be starting to explore beyond a hook and try to come up with...
Absolutely, 100%. Both these questions are very relevant. Thank you very much. It is striking how many times it says Sisyphus in these psukim. I was expecting to see numerous comments about this. I really didn't, to be honest with you. The one thing I would say that I think fits a little bit with something we said so far, I think you could argue that one form of tzitzis is describing the string. You know, so it starts off, make tzitzis. Okay, I mean, that, you know, put the strings on the cord. Fine, that it has to say. Then it says, on the tzitzis, put the strand of the tchelis. Okay, that makes sense that it says this again. I think the real kicker is number three. Vayalachem l'tzitzis, and it will be for you tzitzis.
It's a very different usage of the word.
Right, so I want to remind you what Rashi said. Rashi said the word could be defined in one of two ways. One is kind of like, you know, tassel, strings, whatever it is. And the other is something at which someone gazes. So maybe the first two are more a description of the item. And the third is the purpose of the item. And now that you have this, it'll be something on which to gaze. Something worthy of your attention. I don't know.
But that just leads to more questions. Why do you want to gaze?
I mean, that's in the puzzle.
So you gaze so that you want to look at something else.
Ah, so that's an interesting thing. And I don't know if we know the answer
to... It would remind you to use that famous story, the Midrash, of somebody whose sister kept flat hitting his face because he was doing some care.
I think we could say it one of two ways, and I don't know if we really know the answer. One way to say it is looking at the tzitzis is a symbol for us, and it gives us focus and reminds us of God and His mitzvot, which is what you said a moment ago. Again, to sprinkle it with the Ramban, that specifically the tchelis of the tzitzis reminds us of the expanse of the beauty in God's world. You could say it in different ways, one approach. The other thing which you're touching on is a really interesting thing to think about, that perhaps it's not enough for God to tell me, don't follow your eyes. You know, meaning, don't follow your eyes with negative things that you see. Perhaps God has to tell me, don't follow your eyes, rather look at something else. And I don't know if we have to know if it's more the first or more the second.
So this becomes a hook. Because if looking at the strings evokes something, then what does it evoke? Is it
Uschar temes chom mitzvos Hashem. You should remember the mitzvos of God. I mean, that's explicit in the puzzle.
Right, so you're supposed to make that connection all the time.
Right, so that's not a hook. Not why, I mean, a chok is a mitzvah that's like beyond our comprehension. We have no idea. Yeah.
But why does it have that property?
Okay. So this is God's idea. God knows.
This becomes a chok.
Your usage of the term chok is not correct in this context. I just want to clarify. Chok, that's not what the word chok means. Chok means if you want to say that there's a certain...
Mysterious.
Okay. That's just, okay. But the point is, God tells us, in the end of the day, God creates a symbol for us. This is what the symbol means. We could look at it and keep on walking, which many of us do. Most of us do, most of the time. Or we could take it and reflect on it. And this is what God is urging us to do. Yeah. Thank you. All right.
In the first paragraph, you pointed out in the first session the unusual form of heart, called Lubavka instead of called Lubavka. And here we have the same construction again. So I've already forgotten the significance you explained in the first paper. Could you recount that and explain?
Yeah, it's interesting.
By the way, that the same form occurs in the, I guess it's from the Lampi in Suki de Zimra. Masatai Lababo, not Marmabaneka. Also, one of the Tehillim that we add for Shabbat. The double net form occurs.
Yeah, no, thank you. So what we said earlier, we brought down the idea of Rashi. Rashi brings down from the Gemara, that Levavcha, which is, sounds like a language of hearts, B'shnei Yitzrecha, with both your inclinations, the evil inclination and the passive inclination. So it's a point of discussion what that means, the evil inclination. Anyway, it's interesting. I did not see anyone make the point here on this verse, though it's certainly fair, especially if we said it on the first paragraph of Shema. I think you could very well say, just it's actually the other side of what we said last time. Because last time we spoke about how we love God with all of our hearts. And okay, I understand how I love God with my good inclination. How do I love God with my evil inclination? How does one? So we had discussions there. Now it's the other way. Don't follow your hearts. I think it's easy to understand, don't follow your negative ideas that come out of your heart. I think many times we fall prey to basic good intentions that maybe we haven't fully thought through. Maybe it's basically good intention, but it's tinged by some not so good intentions. So I think we could argue that too. Don't follow your clearly bad thoughts, don't follow them, and even some of your good thoughts that maybe you're not applying appropriately, maybe you shouldn't follow those either. I think that's
me. With that lead, I suggest it means don't decide for yourself what you think is the good right thing to do. Listen to the misspoke.
Right, I think that's an excellent point, and I think it fits wonderfully with the preceding words. Velo sasuru, don't, let's translate that as don't wander. So sometimes we have the best of intentions, but it doesn't fit with, and sometimes it's at odds with what God tells us to do in our lives. That's so even if it's with the best of intentions, that could also be inappropriate. Thank you very much. That's interesting.
Anybody talk about the fact that the tzitz in Hebrew also means a flower, and that this
yes.
may have more to do with the knots, not just simple strings, but the knots make something that could be considered a decoration? Floral.
So I'll tell you what I saw. Forgive me for not sharing it. I saw Rav Sham Shrafal Hirsch spoke about this, and I think an earlier commentator spoke about this, but I don't remember who, that it's language of flower. So it seems the most basic thing is not as much decorative as much as it's essentially this, the string is kind of blossoming off of the garment, so to say. It's the garment ends here, and it kind of keeps on growing down. Rav Hirsch has a whole piece where he talks about the fact that we have in Navi sometimes the garment that a person wears is symbolic of their mitzvah observance, of their mitzvah observance, of their actions in this world. And so the idea of having a garment that I'm wearing and now having something flowering from that garment and adorning that garment in a way and extending beyond that garment, it's a very interesting mashal for like the nature of my conduct in this world and how I should always connect my conduct to God and the mitzvos and so on and so forth. But he does go on the idea of the flower. Yeah, thank you very much. Yeah, Aaron.
Is that a little note in the pasuk? I never looked at it this way before. I don't know if it's valid, but it says, reads M-O-T-O, we usually think of that, that's referring to the tzitzit, but maybe it means that you see him, you see God within the mitzvah.
Interesting. Thank you. Maybe the last comment from Nancy, maybe, and then we'll go on a little bit. Probably time at the end still. But no.
I just wanted to give an example that you have given of you and perhaps the goodness of your heart, but perhaps misdirected. And I remember a couple of times you told us about somebody who had asked not to be visited when they were sick. They didn't want visitors.
Right.
And people in all good intentions aim to visit, and it was really not what was appropriate
right.
for that person. So that sometimes even you're trying to do a really good thing, you're trying to be the best person possible, and sometimes, as Art said, not don't you, sometimes you consult others or or use judgment from, you know, get input from others before you do this good thing. So it's also, don't turn after your good impulses sometimes, and just as you shouldn't turn after your bad impulses in the first paragraph.
Thank you very much. Thank you. What a wonderful example, Nancy.
Oh, I know.
No, thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Okay, let's go on. Leman Tizkaru. By the way, people might wonder, you hear sometimes in shul, people get to Leman Tizkaru and they emphasize the Zion, Leman Tizkaru. There's a reason to do that. If one says it quickly, it sounds like Leman Tizkaru. Tizkaru, so that you reap reward, like schar is reward. Leman Tizkaru is so that you remember. So therefore, traditionally, we emphasize Leman Tizkaru. The only problem is some people, the more they emphasize the Zion, the more it sounds like a sin. But that's a separate story. But Leman Tizkaru, so that you remember. Va'asisem es kol mitzvosoi. And that you should perform all of my mitzvos. And Rav Schwab says on this that the implication is that every single mitzvah in God's Torah needs this focus to really do it right and to always kind of stay on the straight and narrow, which again gets into this issue of not exclusively a mitzvah and a command and an act, but a whole approach and a message. The Sforno says this idea that you should remember, it's just an interesting wording that he uses. He discusses the fact that you should turn yourselves away from thoughts of nothingness. In other words, it's interesting. I think up until now, the way we've been seeing it in the Pesukim, the image of tzitzis is, you know, you have this temptation, you have that temptation. Don't allow yourself to succumb to temptation. Focus on God and his mitzvos. And that's very real. There's another issue. Sometimes you don't have these great temptations. We have so many distractions. You know, and it's not this burning temptation of some terrible thing, but just, I mean, we have it sometimes in life. We get so fixated on something, and maybe we get angry about it, maybe we don't get angry about it. And then every now and then we take a step back and say, why did I spend so much time and energy on this? So the Sforno says, that's the meaning here of Leman Tizkaru. That by having the tzitzis and looking at the tzitzis, that keeps us focused, not just keeps us away from bad, but keeps us focused on good. V'yisem kidoshim lelokeichem. And you should be holy to your God. Rav Schwab points out that the word kadosh, we of course translate it as holy. It's not what the word really, really means. The word kadosh means separate. That's really what it means. And the image that he draws is, imagine a person constantly striving to be a little more separate from the mundane world and a little more connected to God, a little more focused on God. And if we take this as something that a person says every day, and again, the idea of the tzitzis, a person is constantly thinking about these tzitzis and the message associated with these tzitzis, so it means that essentially every day I'm trying harder and harder to be a little bit more separate from the world. I don't mean it in an elitist way, I don't mean it in an island kind of way, in an antisocial kind of way, just a little more separate from the mundane realm of this world and a little more connected to God. Imagine a ladder. Is taking another step up the ladder. So that's how he understands Visem Kadoshim Lelokeichem. Should be separate towards your God, to your God. You know, it's in a kind of in God's direction, so to say. Ani Hashem Elokeichem, Asher Hotzeisi Eschem Me'eretz Mitzrayim, Lios Lachem Lelokim. I am Hashem, your God, that took you out of Egypt to be for you a God. Ani Hashem Elokeichem. I am Hashem, your God. Okay, there's a lot that jumps out in this pasuk. Just look at this for a moment. What's the significance between Hashem and Elokeichem? It seems redundant. What is the message of talking about the fact that he took us out of Egypt? And then why, to whatever extent, there's a significance to Hashem and Elokeichem, the pasuk ends, Ani Hashem Elokeichem. So it says, like the phrase seems redundant, Ani Hashem Elokeichem, and then we say the same phrase more or less twice. So it's like four times over. You know, well, what's going on? Okay, so let's go step by step. So first of all, Ani Hashem, generally the connotation of the name Hashem is that God is merciful and benevolent, and the general connotation of the name Elokim is that God is just, but many times the connotation then is that God punishes. So, Ani Hashem Elokeichem. Rashi explains, I'm both. I'm absolutely ready to reward you, and if you don't do what you're supposed to, I'm also ready to punish you. And by the way, again, this is not written in conjunction with Shema, but it's fascinating how it links so well with the Shema. It links well with the second paragraph of the Shema, with the idea if you do the good things, you'll be rewarded. If you do the bad things, you'll be punished. But it's so powerfully connected to Shema Yisrael, Hashem Elokeinu, Hashem Echad. The recognition that everything is from God. That the blessings are from God and the challenges are from God. It's all from God. He's one. So Ani Hashem Elokeichem, I'm all of it. Both sides of it. That I took you out of Egypt. We referred to this already. Rashi says the pshat is, I had this in mind when I took you out. I had my mitzvos, I had you being taken the charge of keeping my mitzvos in mind when I took you out. This is why I took you out. You could say this in different ways. You could say it, I sort of said a little bit tongue-in-cheek earlier, you know, as hey, that was the deal. But you could say something else. You could say that I performed these tremendous miracles and I put so much effort into taking you out of Egypt because I saw such greatness in you and such potential in you as a people. And that potential manifests itself with the fulfillment of the Torah and mitzvahs. That's why you survived as a nation. What were the odds that you would have survived as a nation in Egypt? That's why you survived as a nation. That's why you were taken out. It's such a remarkable thing to think about. We say this, you know, at least twice a day for those who daven three times a day. We say, God took us out of Egypt. Us? I mean, he says, I took you out of Egypt. But the answer is he took our people out of Egypt. And if you see this as an expression of the opinion in which God holds the Jewish people, it's relevant for all of us. It wasn't just that generation. I've certainly shared this in shul. Nancy, I won't test you with what I'm about to say, but I think it's the Sfas Emes says, we say at the Seder, B'chol dor v'dor chai v'adam liros esatzmo kilu yatzim mitzrayim, that in every generation a person is obligated to see himself as if he left Egypt. Okay, so that means, think about the story and be inspired by the story. Sfas Emes says, a person should always say to him or herself at the Seder, you know, all these miracles and wonders that we talk about, God had me in mind too when he performed those miracles to take the Jewish people out of Mitzrayim. It wasn't just that generation. It was all of us. It was the future of Klal Yisrael. I and what I can accomplish was also sufficiently worthy for God to perform miracles to take out of Egypt. It's an interesting thing to think about. So God says, I took you out of Egypt. That's how we should think about things. Now, maybe the best question here on this pasuk is why does it say I am Hashem your God twice? So Rashi, one pshat that Rashi says is if you've been listening to these psukim, so you say to yourself, wow, this God, he's such a benevolent God, he's willing to, he gives me this charge to do the mitzvos, and you know, I know from other places in the Torah that if I do the mitzvos, I get rewarded. So he's giving me a package that if I want to do the mitzvos, I can get great reward. If I feel spiritually uplifted, maybe I'll sign up for the package. But maybe I don't want the package. Maybe I'll just relax and I'll enjoy this world. So some people want to, you know, do all this stuff and enjoy all these great rewards from God. Maybe I'll just take plan B. So Rashi says, that's why it says, Ani Hashem Elokeichem twice. I'm Hashem your God if you sign up, and I'm Hashem your God if you don't sign up also. Either way, I'm Hashem your God. That's how Rashi understands it, one shot at least. And just to share another thought, Rav Schwab has a beautiful idea. Rav Schwab says there's different ways in which we relate to God and the world around us. So we think of God many times as the God who took the Jews out of Egypt. And that's one example, that's a very strong example of God intervening and making things happen in this world. A person davens that everything should go well in Israel because we want God to protect the Jewish people. And so on and so forth. And a person, you know, heaven forbid, a person has a loved one who's ill and daven, the person should get better because we're ready for God, you know, lahavdil to roll up his sleeves and get in the fray. That's one kind of manifestation of God in this world. Ani Hashem Elokeichem asher otzeisi eschem me'eretz Yisrael. I am Hashem, your God, that took you out of Egypt. But Rav Schwab says there's another model of Hashem. Of course, it's the same God. But olam kiminhago noeg, the world just following the normal patterns of the world. The basic laws of nature, the basic beauty of the world around us, that's also God's world. So both are emphasized. I'm Hashem, your God, who took you out of Egypt. That's one model, and amazing, and interventions, and miracles, and wonders. And without the miracles and wonders, I'm still Hashem, your God. And again, it's particularly interesting to think about the context of tzitzis, since this is about looking at it, remembering the mitzvahs of God. So understand that it's incumbent upon us to see God, not only in the miracles and wonders, but in the day-to-day of this world too. To see God in that light also. Interesting to think about in the context of the tchelas. You know, this idea again, that through the different aspects of the world that which we know, we're supposed to see God within them, we're supposed to see reminders of God within the blue of the tchelas and the sea and the sky, etc. That's just another point Rav Schwab says. Just a technical clarification, then we'll open it up if there's any more questions or comments. The last word of Shema, technically, is Ani Hashem Elokeichem. That's the last word of the verse. The first word of the bracha which follows Shema is Emes. And that, by the way, is true in the morning davening, and that's true in the evening davening.
No pun intended.
Okay, very well. So, Ani Hashem Elokeichem, the idea that here it is, the next word we're going to say is Emes, truth. And we just got finished referring to God, so we immediately join the Emes to Ani Hashem Elokeichem. But that's like the practice, and even when we talk about just saying Shema, even out of the context of tefillah, our practice is to say the word Emes afterwards, but the Pasuk, that's where the Pasuk is Elokeichem. Okay, any comments or questions?
Yes.
It is the same root that a person acting in an unfaithful manner. Yes.
Okay.
Very strong language. You're right.
My second question is, I'm going back to this first set of classes. Talking about the rain, that's going to fall, the early rain and the late.
You know, Judy, I'm just going to, maybe I'll tell you what, let's just see if right now if we have any questions on this paragraph, okay? And if not, we could talk afterward. You know what I mean? I just want to, because there's not that much time left, I just want to, okay, if we can. Mark?
I was just going to say, perhaps inappropriately, but this, when it says Hashem, Hashem is spelled explicitly, that is Hashem's, that is his true name, which we're not allowed, obviously, to pronounce.
Interesting.
So he's saying, you know, don't misinterpret me with a ball or anybody. But this,
good.
You know,
yeah.
And it's me.
Wonderful. Thank you very much. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
I'll take the money outside.
I'll give you everything they gave me for tonight's class, okay?
That sounds fair.
Anything else?
Would MS have been, we say Omain at the end of almost everything else, signifying we're certified to us that it's true. So would Omain after that paragraph be any different from MS?
So the only thing is, technically speaking, at least Ashkenazim, generally speaking, don't say Omain to our own statement. We say Omain to someone else's statement. As a general rule.
This is God's statement.
Right, but we're... we're the ones, it's God, it's originally God's statement, but when we're saying it, I'm saying it, you're saying it. You know what I mean? So, but it is, I think, in concept, I think it's extremely similar. But technically, we normally wouldn't say it. There's like two exceptions in the Siddur, but generally speaking, Ashkenazim don't say Amen after our own. Yeah. But it's I think it's a very interesting comparison. It's very similar.
I was reading that after you make the tzitzit, you're supposed to remember the mitzvot of Hashem, and then do them. But then that same like progression is repeated right afterwards. Lamad tizkru v'asem tzvot zosad. Again, you should remember them, and then you should do them. And the only thing in between them is the straying concept.
The what?
The straying away after your heart, after your eyes. So what it reminded me of was, this is the ideal. The first progression is the ideal. You should make the tzitzis and you should remember the mitzvahs and you should do them. But if, perchance, you happen to stray after your heart or after your eyes, again, come back to it, get back on the horse, and then, that, like what you were saying earlier, that's what it's all about, to make those small steps towards the goal. You might go up, you might go down, just to keep going on.
I think that's a wonderful point. I think it's a wonderful point, and it certainly... The many commentators point out, not necessarily in this concept, but I think it certainly fits like what you're saying. The verse tells us, Sheva yipol tzadik v'kam. That a righteous person falls seven times and gets up. Okay. So the normal way in which that verse is understood is you can't keep a good person down. You know, person's a tzadik, they can fall seven times, they keep on getting it. Others have said, the way to understand the pasuk is what makes someone such a sterling individual is having the experience of failure. One can never reach heights if one never fails. And if someone falls, that's the greatest proof that they reached. And they failed, but then they get back up again. And that experience of failing and then getting up is what makes a person a great person. That's certainly, I think it fits with what you're saying. Thank you very much. Yes.
Just to kind of wrap up the course a little bit, I want to just go back to the first paragraph and make a contrast there. The first paragraph, we talk about the heart in the context of you shall love Hashem with all your heart, and also talks about I command you to be upon your heart. And then the third paragraph, it talks about don't explore after your heart. So the contrast in the first one is very positive.
Yeah.
All your mind, all your energy, and there are not so fast. There is some ambiguity there about where you are in process also with us.
Yeah, I think it's a wonderful point. I think it fits in with the point Mr. Boyer's made earlier, which is probably the key is the word lo sasuru, the words lo sasuru. That if the heart is a vehicle for the expression or the finding of the Avas Hashem, the love of God, like you're referring to from that verse, then go with it. Just go with it. But if it's a wandering without direction, without focus, then it could be problematic. I also just want to point out, just following on your point, there's not a concept of following the eyes in a good way. There's a concept of following the heart in a good way, right? You know, certainly. But we don't have that symmetry vis-a-vis the eyes. And I think this speaks to the fact that, by definition, eyes and sight is a very external type of thing. And so that, to live life in that external focus, it's never gonna be a path. To live life following the heart can be a tremendous thing. But one has to have the right direction. And that, I think, is the contrast in the first paragraph and the third. Thank you very much. Thank you. Jordan.
There's a parallel or associated pasuk in Devarim that relates to this also, where it says, G'divim ta'aselecha ha'ar bakan kan v'chasha te'chasaga. So when it says G'divim, I'm thinking first that this might relate to the idea of tzitzit as the association of growth. But I'm wondering also what else Gedilim might refer to. And also there's a difference between in this paragraph that we're talking about, it says Likneichem, and there's the other word in Devarim is Kasut. And I'm wondering about the difference between a Beged and a Kasut.
Very interesting.
I see the three pieces.
I'm not sure what the difference would be between Beggin and Xosa. Forgive my ignorance. I don't know. It's a fit. Gedilim is it? I think your comment about language. Well, I just want to repeat Jordan's basic point, the first point, because there's another pasuk in the Torah talks about the mitzvah tzitzis, which refers to tzitzis as gedilim. Now, gedilim literally seems to be translated as some type of language of fringes. It's interesting to think about gadil could be a language of legadil, which is like to grow. It's interesting to think about the context of, say, the flowering that we were talking about before with tzitzis. Presumably on the most literal of levels, again, you have this garment, and then there's this growth coming from the garment, you know, it's an extension of the garment. Presumably that's what it means on the most literal of levels. But I think your idea that in some sense tzitzis is a means by which to become greater, and it's kind of like the Yisem Kedoshim Le'elokeichem, to become holy to our God. And this image that inspires us to keep on striving, I think it's a very worthwhile point. Thank you very much. Thank you. Linda? I'll tell you, Linda is... You know, thank you. I promised halachos at the beginning, and then I did some of them, not all. I do have the list that I originally had, so just give me a moment. A lot of it we already did. There's an interesting halacha that if someone is in shul when they're saying Shema and they're not up to the spot, there's an idea of saying Shema along with the congregation. Because Shema is such a public affirmation of that we believe in God. So here's all these people sitting here saying they believe in God. What are you saying by not joining in with them? So if someone is in a spot in the davening where they can interrupt, so let's say a person just started davening, and they're like, he's still in Pesukei Nesimra. So Shema is also a pasuk of praise to God. So they can stop what they're doing and say Shema. Let's say a person is like already in the brachos preceding Kriyash, but it's not a good time to interrupt or anything. So it's very interesting. So it's brought in halacha, is a person is supposed to act like they're saying Shema in the moment. You know, but you know, kind of like cover their eyes for a moment. You know, in other words, the point is, it's not heaven forbid that you don't agree with what they're saying. You're just not up to that spot. But that's just an interesting thing. I believe we spoke about this, but there's clearly an idea, specifically in the first pasuk of Shema, of trying our best to have real kavanah, real focus on what we're saying. It is prohibited to say the first pasuk of Shema while walking. One is at the very least preferable to be sitting, you know, because one focuses better, but at the very least to stay in one place. You'll hear people sometimes prolong the word of, or elongate the word of Echad when they're saying Shema. So the idea of that is that when we get to the Ches, Echa, we're supposed to be thinking of the fact that God rules over the heaven and earth. And when we get to the Dalet, we're supposed to think that God is the only force in this world and governs over all the north, south, east, west of the world, the four directions. And there also was an idea of emphasizing this. You really hear people say Echad. So that's about, presumably, we emphasize that God is one, as opposed to like Acher, you know, which is other gods and then things of that sort. But we emphasize that God is one. There's certainly the idea of covering one's eyes during the Shema. There's a real concept. The idea is to focus oneself. And I think everything else halachically that I was going to mention, we touched on at different points over these 3 weeks. Thank you. Thank you for bringing me back. Okay, so I really want to thank you all for coming again. Thank you to Stuart and Aaron for another wonderful idea. Thank you very, very much. And stay tuned for more.
2 weeks from tonight, the halacha starts.
Okay. Well, so we're starting. Do you know how many weeks we said that was going to be?
3 weeks.
3 weeks.
Through the 29th.
Right. We're going to start not this Monday, not 2 weeks from tonight. We're starting a halacha class, God willing. And that'll basically run us up to Hanukkah, which we say Hallel so many times over Hanukkah. So that'll be a 3-week series on Hanukkah. God willing, people are already making suggestions for other series, which I'm sure will be wonderful. Thank God. And by the way, this is just a shameless plug, but on a totally different thing. Next Monday night, same place, same time, just a class on practically how one Tovel's Kalim, you know, immerses vessels and what they have to immerse, things like that. Different, a little bit of a change of pace.
Do a
but
demonstration?
What?
Do a demonstration?
I don't think so. Okay.